It's Creative Mornings Helsinki. I'm Leni and I'm hosting the event today. Our theme is weird and we have an awesome speaker, Marco Casagrande.
Well, good morning to everybody. My name is Marco and I will speak about urban acupuncture and some ideas of the third generation city. Most of the works and this thinking is based in Taipei, Taiwan. In Helsinki we have a small multidisciplinary architecture office. Our works are in Finland and in other countries. This is the start. In 2003 I was invited by the Taipei city government to do some sketches, some outlines for ecological restoration of the urbanized Taipei basin, 7 million people. Same time the same city government was destroying this place. It's an unofficial settlement called Treasure Hill. More or less 400 households. They were bulldozing down the houses and destroying the farms and destroying the connections between the houses. Then I researched this place and I found out that actually Treasure Hill is providing those kind of issues, those kind of solutions that the city is asking me to say to them. This is an ecological settlement. They were composting all their organic waste. They were stealing electricity from the city, but not too much. They were stealing water from the city, but not too much. You know, the pipes are leaking anyhow. And then composting and, for example, with the grey waters, they were taking it by gravity through patches of jungle, which root cleanse the water and then use it for their farms. They are urban farmers, also urban nomads, going from this compound to the surrounding city, harvesting something that the modern city calls waste. So I decided that instead of giving some data for the city, I will work with this community. And I will try to stop this destruction and try to make this as an example for Taipei City. So I didn't have any manpower nor construction material. So we went to local universities and start recruiting people. In the end, we have 200 students. And some of the students started to, some pretty beautiful Taiwanese girl students went to the nearby construction site. They were building a big concrete bridge, saying what we're going to do. So the construction workers start to steal material for us. Every morning, like 7, 8, the lorries would come and then just like offload 10-15% for us. And then we start rebuilding. So we just turn around the process what the city was doing. Instead of this destruction, leaving it slowly to rotten on the place, we start to make those connections back to in between houses so that this like nervous network of this urban organism could like revitalize. And then we restarted the farms. The residents were really scared of us in the beginning. They thought that no, in a way, I was representing the city government, but that meant destruction for them. The line between actually destruction and construction is very small. Somewhere is zero. When you think of destruction, usually you think you're totally dead, or construction is totally on the other side, but it's just a small tune. Either you slowly die or you start getting constructive. This is a window. The whole Treasure Hill is a ruin. The people who live there, they think in this way that it is stupid if you finalize a house. It is stupid if you spend too much energy. Nature should somehow be the co-architect. From the beginning, you leave things unfinished and nature will finish it up. But same time, that is tuning the houses very nicely together with the jungle and the rest of the nature, the river nature and so forth. So for me, the realization from this was the understanding of a ruin as something man-made, which has become part of nature. Quite often we think ruins in a very destructive ways, but it's not so. Our control is destructive. So then if you think the ruining process is in urban scale, so then we start thinking about the third generation city. The first generation city is the city which is on the place because of nature. In Taipei, you have a big river full of fish, transportation, water, cleaning babies. Then mountains around it, which is protecting Taipei from the straight hits of the typhoons. It's a floodplain, very fertile, can afford the city. Then that's the first generation city. Second generation city is the industrial city. Modern man or industrial mechanical man has claimed independence from nature. And this is more or less the stage where we are now. But what is the third generation city? What is the organic ruin of the industrial city? Industrialism is young. It will learn how to become part of nature. Some sort of ruining process. Treasure Hill is matriarchal. If you research or study the illegal communities or urban farmers or collective gardens, usually they are matriarchal. City is a very patriarchal system, not to mention industrial city. But these, which are tied still with local knowledge and with the original ground, they are matriarchal. This is Mrs. Chen, 86 years old at the time, matriarch of Treasure Hill. So then we start to interview these kind of local knowledge professors, because the urbanization or hyper-urbanization of Taipei City has occurred after the Second World War. It's a very short time. And these kind of persons remember the whole process. When we interview fishermen, they remember every fish, what year it didn't come anymore. So this industrialization or degeneration, they know it. It's not a fiction for them. So in the end, Treasure Hill was rebuilt, and the city agreed that, okay, we make it legal. So the same people that 3 weeks ago were destroying this place suddenly turned their coat and said, okay, it's fine. And it's because of rumors. When the students came there, a lot of rumors start to spread in the city. You can design whole cities just by rumors. So the rumors start to go, people get curious, they come there, start to volunteer. When people get enough curious, of course, media comes in. When media comes in, the next in the ecosystem is politicians. So after media, politicians came there and start posing in this place, same guys who were destroying it 3 weeks before. And in the end, this is now made legal as public artwork. The houses don't meet any building codes, it's built by those normal people, so they couldn't legalize the houses, but they said, okay, we invite an artist from Finland and make this as a public artwork. So they are living in art now. And after this Treasure Hill and getting in touch with the local knowledge, we continued with the research. We set up our own research center in Taipei called Ruin Academy. We occupy a house which was 5 floors high, abandoned apartment house, and then destroyed all the interior walls, knocked out all the windows, also blew up the basement so that there is only the primary structure of the house. And then we start drilling holes through the whole building, from the roof to the basement, so that it can rain inside. You know, when you have rain, topsoil and light, so things can grow. And also this is totally done with volunteers coming from different disciplines, not only architecture. Architecture alone is nothing. So instead of windows, we start to grow bamboo to keep the storm waters outside and also to make a noise barrier. This is the basement, so that we eventually we find the original ground and can start putting trees to it. Here is one bed. It's on the wheels, so that if it's raining straight on top of you, you can roll to some more dry corner. Students working, sleeping. Here is one small garden for them, vegetable garden. And it's kind of like a caveman style. So you can burn fires inside, there is a sauna, public sauna on the top floor, and people do what they do. So we think this as an academic squatting. People come from different disciplines, different universities, this is the sauna, and then the city government is giving us tasks, like, okay, please research this or do design for this, and then we provide new kind of thinking. This is a big inspiration, it's an urban bonsai. So he knows, he has found this a small seam in the facade, and he knows exactly how much water is coming in, what are the winds, how much topsoil comes with the winds, and it's growing there. I have been following him since 2010, and it has not grown an inch. So it's it's there. And this is it. This ain't nothing else, but this is this. This is the big brother or sister, cousin, something on the opposite side of the street. Same species, five floors high. And these roots don't touch ground. So we ask a structural engineer with a scanning device that explain us where are the roots going. So he goes in the building and then gives us a report that there is not one set of roots, but there is two set of roots. Like one set of roots seems to be just for structure. It is going into the reinforced concrete slabs and it's holding the whole house as its structure. And the second set of roots is going to the sewage system. So this tree knows exactly how much people are flushing the toilet, how they use the water and so on, and it takes all the energy from this house. It's living because of this house, taking both structure and energy. So this is the third generation condition. In nature, of course, this happens in all different scales. Nature only wants one thing, existence maximum, like biggest life in the given conditions. This is what people do. This is like the most expensive land in the Taipei city. The pink building is Taipei World Trade Center. So three banks have been fighting for this for something like 20 years. But it's so expensive, so nobody has gained control. And it's a hole in the city, so the anarchist grandmothers attack. And the anarchist grannies have changed this into urban farm. It's a collective farm. And it's been going there for decades now, 20 years. Children come from school, they help the grannies to carry water, do their homeworks and so on, so it's culture. And this is the first generation's way of urbanism, which is penetrating through the industrial city. This coexistence is somehow the third generation, possibly. This is all the illegal urban farms, collective gardens, settlements in Taipei city. So this is the actual map of urban acupuncture. You have the urbanized Taipei basin, which is centrally governed system, mechanism for 7 million people, highly polluting. And then you have those acupuncture needle points where people are penetrating through the industrial city and tuning the whole industrial city towards the organic. This is the basin. And this is the solution what the official city can give for coexisting with the river nature. Other side is the mechanical industrial man. Other side is water, and then 12 meters high reinforced concrete wall. Never seen the water there. These are our topics so far: illegal architecture, urban acupuncture, river urbanism, urban nomad, organic machine, and parasite urbanism. But all these are based on the local knowledge, on talking with these anarchist grannies and other professors of local knowledge. I want to show something what local knowledge can do. This is kind of an insect architecture now. It's in Shenzhen, South China. So there's like a compound of migrating workers here on the left-hand side. So we talk with them and they say that they all come from the countryside. That, okay, if you come from the countryside, so you must have local knowledge. You know how to deal with nature. But instead they are building those skyscrapers. And then we ask, these people came from Guangxi province, that if you come from Guangxi, what do you really know instead of the skyscraper? And they say that we know everything about bamboo. Is it okay? And then we ask the construction guys that what do you need? And they say that we need some sort of a social club, something to play guitar and sing karaoke. Is it okay? And then we start building together with them. And this structure, what they did, it don't have any nails or any industrial connectors. It's only bamboo. It's a big bucket. Outside is the city. This architecture is very weak, in a sense. It's not based on the idea of strength or control. It's organic and weak. But it's still so strong that when you get inside, the surrounding city totally disappears. And the way they work was beautiful. It's like insects making cocoon, like no big effort, just same movement again and again, and then slowly this start coming up. Beautiful microclimate inside. Material budget is zero. Nighttime, they put one construction light inside, so it turns into a disco. It's beautiful. Here is a karaoke event cooking up. But this is the most important. Like, this is what local knowledge is about. So from the beginning, the construction workers took nature as the co-architect. They didn't even want to do a roof or anything like that. They just said to me, like, oh, wait. And then after a couple of months, the whole building becomes green and the microclimate is even better. It's a fantastic work. And it's really in their blood, no effort. So then, learning about this local knowledge and learning about Treasure Hill and talking with those guys, we start thinking, also asked by the Taipei city government, like about the third generation city. They say that, okay, can you think about some sort of like urban organism and put it into this island? It's a flooding island on Danshui River. So when the typhoon comes, the whole island disappears. There is no houses. Around 1 kilometer long and 300 meters wide. And they say that, can you try between 15,000 and 25,000 people in this place? And so then we start to think about of a system that instead of making a ready house, we just have like a primary structure of a city, kind of like a mountain. And then the people start moving in and start building their own houses, just like in Treasure Hill. So we ended up with this kind of a cube. It's made of wood, CLT, cross-laminated timber. 6 times 6 times 6 meters with wooden joints. So you have big sticks, putting them together, have cubes, then more cubes, and suddenly you have a city. And like in our role, we thought that, okay, we give this primary structure and some main roads for circulation, but that's it. Then we step away, and then it becomes something like this. We don't know how it becomes. People do what they do. Build their houses, make their communities, build their farms, and so forth. Very simple structure. And then all the roofs are left for farms and gardening, because that's what they do anyhow in Taipei, if you let them do. The water is taken from the polluted river, then cleaned up and used for the farms. We pump it up for some patches of jungle, just like in Treasure Hill, and then by gravity it starts coming to infrastructure use and for the farms. So we've been trying to think how to build this kind of organic machine as Treasure Hill is. Maybe look something like this. And inside is a very, very simple structure. Then the flood water scenario. So when the river is flooding, the first 6 meters get underwater. So the first layer of the first cubes of this paracity is not built at all. It's left empty. Normally people use it for Tai Chi or fixing their boats or whatever. But when water comes, so there it comes. It's based on free flooding instead of this. And we hope that this Treasure Hill will start, this paracity will start growing from our little island, that it would grow over the flood walls of Taipei and start reconnecting again the city with the river nature, like a positive cancer. Or some sort of a high-tech slum. This is now the cube in one-to-one scale, CLT. It takes 1.5 hours to put one up. It don't burn, and it has a very good earthquake resistance. And you can make it bigger as it grows or dismantle some pieces. Here's a smaller version for a village in Estonia. Some sort of a self-made city, like slums are. The initial, like, you know, the city has to say yes, okay, build here. But after that, it's much more control for the people. It's a different way of thinking. Okay, thank you.